and welcome to the International Daily Roundup with People's Dispatch, where we bring you some of the top stories from across the globe. Let's take a look at today's headlines. Venezuela pardons opposition leaders accused of conspiracy. WHO study points to massive setback in healthcare due to COVID-19 pandemic. Filipino activists approach Supreme Court seeking protection from killings. Rafael Correa's sister will try to formalize his candidacy for vice president of Ecuador. Hamas announces ceasefire deal with Israel. Venezuela has issued a pardon to opposition figures, including various leaders accused of conspiring against President Maduro, in the wake of upcoming parliamentary elections. Out of the 110 individuals who have been pardoned, more than 50 are leaders of the opposition who are either in prison, have fled the country, or are seeking asylum in various embassies in Venezuela. The move signals the government's attempts to increase participation in the upcoming elections, which the opposition has vowed to boycott. While announcing the list, Minister of Communications Jorge Rodriguez stated that they intend to deepen the process of national reconciliation for national union so that political issues are settled by peaceful means and by electoral means. Despite the pardon, opposition leaders have come out with statements reaffirming the convictions that the 2018 elections were rigged. The World Health Organization came out with a study on Monday stating that the COVID-19 pandemic could set back decades of progress in the healthcare industry across the world. The survey assessed responses from health services and institutions between May to July from over 100 nations. It stated that the impact of the COVID-19 pandemic on essential services is a source of great concern. Major health gains achieved over the past two decades can be wiped out in a short period. The WHO had also recently raised concerns about the possible impact of COVID-19 on the treatment of HIV/AIDS patients, specifically in the sub-Saharan region of Africa. According to the study, the pandemic crisis has affected routine immunizations by 70%, family planning in over 65%, as well as cancer diagnosis and treatment by 55%. The WHO added that this can develop into a crisis long after the pandemic is dealt with due to the strain it places on the health sector. The study also cites several other concerns which might lead to protracted strain on the health sector. People with health complications, refusing to visit hospitals fearing the virus, and patients being unable to afford non-COVID related services after surviving it are factors that will add to the strain. The WHO stresses these situations could have led to increased death rates across the world. Human rights advocacy group Karapatan Alliance has approached the Philippine Supreme Court for protection from political murders. On September 1st, Tuesday, legal counsels of Karapatan Alliance filed a plea urging the court to take measures to prevent state-sponsored killings and harassment of activists. The submission cited the recent killing of Zara Alvarez, a health activist and member of the Negros Island branch, by unidentified gunmen last month. Alvarez was killed on August 17th, a week after the murder of peace consultant Randy Ekanes on August 10th. The plea demanded that the court grant them the petition for review of amparo and habeas data, legal provisions in the Philippines to deal with extrajudicial killings and forced disappearances. The manifestation opened by noting the recent slew of political murders in the country under the administration of President Rodrigo Duterte. Yesterday, Karapatan posted about death threats against the Negros Island Deputy Secretary Julius Dagatan, who is also a media liaison for left-wing coalition Bayan Muna. Karapatan has documented 328 killings in line with the government's counter-insurgency program since July 2016. The organization has stated that 185 of these murders were of human rights defenders and social movement activists. It also stated that with Alvarez's murder, 13 of their activists have now been killed under the Duterte administration. On Tuesday, Pairina Correa, the sister of Ecuador's former president, Rafael Correa, will try to accept his nomination as a candidate for the vice presidency of Ecuador as her brother's notarized power of attorney. Rafael Correa was elected as the running mate of economist Andres Arauz in the primary elections held in August within the new coalition called the Union for Hope. The coalition is made up of left-wing political parties and social movements. According to a recently reformed electoral law, in order to stand in the elections, the participants are required to present their candidature and accept their nomination in person in the CNE's headquarters. Due to the COVID-19 pandemic, the CNE enabled online registration of candidacy. However, the electoral entity stressed that the candidates elected in the primary elections must appear before the electoral authorities to formalize their participation no later than September 1st. Former President Rafael Correa is currently residing in Belgium and has been a constant victim of the lawfare waged against him by the current President Lenin Moreno's administration. His returning to the country could be met with preventive detentions for the bribe 2012 to 2016 case. Correa has rejected the charges pressed against him and denounced them, as well as the electoral reforms, as a form of political persecution intended to prevent him from running in the elections. On Monday, the Palestinian resistance group Hamas announced that it had reached a ceasefire with Israel that would end the recent hostilities in Gaza. Since early August, Gaza has faced constant aggressions from Israel. This includes bombing of the region from the air, shell attacks from tanks, and attacks on Palestinian fishermen off the Gaza coast. As per the ceasefire deal, both sides have agreed to adhere to several conditions. Hamas sources have told reporters that it and other Palestinian factions have reached an agreement to halt all firings of rockets and dispatching incendiary explosive balloons across the border in response to Israeli provocations and escalations since the first week of August. Israel, on the other hand, said that it will immediately open its border crossing with Gaza to allow the supply of goods and essential items, as well as resume fuel shipments. It would also reopen the fishing zone for Palestinian fishermen and would allow them to fish in the waters for up to 25 kilometers off the Gaza coast. According to a Hamas source, the resuming of fuel supplies would mean Gaza's power plant will be operational again from Tuesday. Due to the fuel shortages, Palestinians in Gaza had access to electricity for only 4 hours a day. Nikolay Mladenov, the United Nations envoy to Israel and the occupied Palestinian territories, welcomed the news in a tweet stating that ending the launching of incendiary devices and projectiles restoring electricity will allow UA to focus on dealing with the COVID-19 crisis. And this is all we have for this episode of the International Daily Roundup. For more such stories and videos, visit our website peoplesdispatch.org, subscribe to our YouTube channel, and follow us on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. Thank you for watching.